With part 4, the Stairway to Heaven guitar lesson will show how to play the complete guitar solo, as well as some additional lead guitar riffs played at the song's ending. With guitar tabs, box pattern diagrams, and a close-up view of the fretboard, we're going to cover each section with a step-by-step approach. The Stairway to Heaven guitar solo is based primarily from the A blues scale. It also has some notes added in from the A natural minor scale. What we'll do with this lesson is, just before breaking down each riff and showing you the tab, we'll show you the box patterns used so you can sort of visualize how to play each riff. And starting with the opening riff, that's going to be based from the A pentatonic minor box pattern along the 5th fret position. And the very first note is going to be a bend on the 3rd string, 7th fret, and it's a whole step bend. And to get a good solid bend, you always want to use multiple fingers. If you look at the tab, below the tab, you'll see the finger numbers to fret with, the suggested finger numbers to fret with, and you'll see the 3rd finger, but also the 1 and 2 fingers in parentheses. Those are the support fingers. And that first bend, and with that, we go to a riff. This is a blues riff. It's going to basically just descend down that box pattern. And we really want to get this riff down because it's played 2 other times later on in the solo. And what it is, we start with that top string, 5th fret, 5, then down to 8, 5, down to 7, 5, and down to 7. And once you know what notes to play, you count it. That's a great way to fall into it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Putting that together with the opening bend. And then the 3rd finger will jump up to the 4th string, and you're going to do a pull-off, 7 to 5, then down to the next string, 7-5 as well, and then we're going to slightly pivot the fingers up to the 8th fret on that 5th string. And we want to get 2 fingers on that for good vibrato. Now you may have noticed this note is outside of the A pentatonic minor box pattern. What we're doing is including a note from the A natural minor scale, which is an F note, and that's outside of the box pattern for blues, but you can harmonize the natural minor together with the blues scale. So let's put together the first phrase from the top. 1, 2, ready, go. One note regarding the opening riff. If you listen closely to the original recording, you're going to hear a little bit of guitar playing just prior to the opening bend. It's a riff that goes 4-2-0-2. It's a second layered or overdubbed guitar. And at the same time that 3rd string 2nd fret is played, which is the A root note, is when the bend occurs. So you can't do both at the same time, but you can do this if you want to kind of copy the original recording a little closer. So just do the 4-2-0, da-da-da, and then kick into the bend. Another option for revving up into that opening bend, and Jimmy Page does this pretty much on all his live recordings that I've seen. Here's another rev up to the opening bend. Da-da-da-da, and then he kicks into the opening bend. So if you want to sort of rev up a little for the opening riff, prior to the opening bend, I should say, those are 2 options for you. From that last note in phrase 1, we take the 3rd finger and we move it along the 8th fret position to the 2nd string. And the 2nd phrase is going to start with a bend on that 2nd string, and again, multiple fingers. And then your pinky, 4th finger, is right there on the top string. We're going to play those 2 notes on the 8th fret top string with the pinky finger, and then after that, let's put that together, and then shift the 3 fingers over, and we're going to do a screaming bend here on the top string. Then we release the bend. We don't sound the release on the way down, so, and then back down to the 5th fret. Let's back it up to the beginning of this phrase, starting with the bend on the 8th fret. And then we shift up. We're going to move up now to the 8th fret position. And we have a phrase here. It's a bunch of notes along the 10th and 8th frets. first finger will be along the 8th fret, third finger will be along the 10th fret. That'll keep your hand, your fretting hand, steady and in position. And if we look on the tab, we're starting with the G section with that pull-off from 10 to 8 on the second string. And then the first finger is going to be sort of partially barred. So that's how that's going to sound, that phrase right there. And then it's followed by 10 and then a pull-off down to 8. 10, pull-off to 8, down to the second string. 10 to 8, pull-off again. And then down to 10 on the third string, which is another F note added to the A blues scale. And that's going to end this riff with a hammer from 8 to 10 with a little vibrato. Let's back it up to the G section, starting with the 10 pull-off to the 8th fret on the 2nd string. And with that, we'll back it up now to the beginning of the phrase, starting with that 8th fret bend on the 2nd string. 1, 2, ready, go. Section 3 starts very much the same as the opening riff in the song. The only difference is we won't sustain that opening bend so much. Another thing is we're going to repeat that descending riff as well. So the opening riff to section 3 sounds like this. And if you're looking at the tab, you'll see that section 3 begins at the end of line 1 with the bend in the first 4 notes, and then the rest of it begins with line 2. So let's start that again from the top and we'll build from there. So we've got the bend. Then we move again, the third finger shifts up to the third string like we did in the previous riffs. And we're, instead of pulling off from 7 to 5, we're just going to pluck each individual note. 7, 5, 7, 5. Da 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 da. And you'll count that in fours. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then we continue to descend down the box pattern to the 5th string 7th fret, and then I'll count this with a 3 count. If we're looking at the tab, it's the 7-5-7. So backing it up a little bit. 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3. And then, a sort of an off-center but pretty cool sounding riff, you're just going to play that 3rd string 5th fret, 1-2-3, and then let go of it. Bum, 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 bum. Kind of chop or chip away at it. Bum. Let's back it up to the beginning. We'll start with the bend. Here we go. And then we repeat that descending riff again. And then it's followed by a barrage of pull-offs. 7-5, move down to the 4th string, and then you do that same maneuver, 7-5 twice. So backing it up to the 3rd string, and then down to the F note again, just like we did in section 1. So let's piece it all together. Section 3 from the top. 1, 2, ready, go. For section 4, we'll start with the same note we ended with in section 3, the 5th string 8th fret, and that's going to be an immediate slide from 8 to 12. So that's the first one count we'll do. It's going to go 1, 2 from that 12th fret slide to the 10th fret of the 4th string. And we're now entering into a new box pattern. We're still in A blues, but now we're along the 10th fret position. So starting with that slide, 1-2, and then that's followed by a pull-off, 12 to 10, down to 12, back up to 10. And I would count that as a 4 count, 1-2-3-4, 1-2, 1-2-3-4, and then the third finger, you're still steadying in position. The third finger We'll go to the 4th string 12th fret, and we're going to slide up now to another box pattern, this time sliding up to the 14th fret, 12 to 14. So it's still that 1-2 that we did in the previous riff. 12 to 14 to 12 on the next string, and then we have a 3-note riff. And then same note again, 12, 14, 13. I'm going to suggest the middle finger for that 13th fret. Let's back it up a little bit from the beginning of section 4. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Now from here we pivot the fingers. We want to get a good bend on the second string 15th fret. And how that riff is going to sound. So it's bend, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we jump to the top string, same fingers pivot up to the top string 15th fret, and we do a screaming bend up there. 15 on the bend, then release down to 15. And then same fingers shift down to the second string. 1, 2, 3, 4 is how I would count that. So backing up to that screaming bend on the top string. So let's put section 4 all together from the top. 1, 2, ready, go. For section 5, we'll start with the same note we ended section 4 with. That's with the middle finger on the 3rd string 14th fret. Also, our first finger is still in position from the previous riff. That's on the 2nd string 13th fret. So we got a 14-13 there. And that's followed by a bend and release on the 2nd string. So we're going to do a strong bend. We're actually sounding 3 different pitches, but only plucking the note once, or the string once. And for the bend and release, the first finger is going to catch the release for that last sounded pitch. So you're bending the 15th fret, then releasing to the normal 15th fret pitch, and then releasing again to the 13th fret pitch. And that's combined with this. And it's repeated 10 times in the original solo. So let's put it together a few times just to hear how it sounds played in succession. And another, let's play a little bit faster than that. And once you get faster, you're going to sort of do a rake effect across the two strings, sort of dragging the pick like so. Sort of dragging it like that, that'll give you a little bit more of a speed effect for this section. So we've got this riff played 10 times. Then what ends this section is we start again with those two notes, but this time we're going to bend the top string, and that's a very slight release, not all the way down. It's just a slight release after that bend that'll lead into the next riff. Let's do that screaming riff again, starting with the two notes here. And that'll lead into the next section. For section 6, we start with a 3-note riff, 12, 15, 12 on that top string. I'm going to use the 3rd finger for the 15th fret. And then it's sort of a descending riff. It goes up, but it's primarily descending. After we do that scream and bend, we go down to the 2nd string. And the best way I would suggest to memorize this next series of notes is memorize this 4-note phrase here, 15, 13, 14, 13. Because that's played twice. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So backing it up to the beginning. And then we have a bend on that 2nd string. And again, using the right fingers, you bend with that 3rd finger, but you have that pinky on the top string for that top string 15th fret. I like to throw a little heavy vibrato if you can on that last note, multiple fingers on that 3rd string 14th fret. Let's put it all together from the top. Here we go. Section 7 is the first of four call and response sections that are going to close out the guitar solo. And what I mean by call and response is on the original recording, you have two guitars exchanging riffs. One guitar provides the call while the other responds with the riff. So the call riff is going to be this. We're going to start on that 13th fret of the second string. It's a pull off from 13 to 12. And then we go back to 13 with the middle finger. I'm going to suggest the middle finger because it's just stronger for this. So after that pull off, go back to the two finger and slide it down to the 10th fret. A little bit better vibrato, a little bit better sustain with that stronger finger. That's a nod to the A natural minor scale. We're throwing in an added B note, which is not part of A blues. So there's that little sort of serious drama-like sort of effect with this riff. For the response riff, we're going to be playing an A blues riff up at the 17th fret position. And the box pattern will be the same box pattern we use for the opening riffs to the solo, because on guitar everything repeats every 12 frets. So same box pattern up at the 17th fret position, but we're going to use different fingers because the frets are a little bit closer and we want to get good tone and control over the bend. So I'm going to suggest to use your 1 and 2 fingers for the opening bend on that 3rd string 19th fret. And then the first finger drags across top 2 strings 17th fret. Then visualize the box pattern. We're going down the box pattern 20, 17. And then we skip a string. We're going to go down to the 19th fret with the middle finger and a 3 note phrase 19 up to 19 and then 17. Dun dun dun. And then, boom, bum, boom. And I think you get better control over the bend using the 1 and 2 fingers. There's a little bit of vibrato on that as well. And I just think with the 1 and 2, you could try it with your 2 and 3 fingers. But I think you get a little bit better control with the 1 and 2. Let's put that response riff together from the top, starting with the bend. For the response riff in section 8, we shift down to the 12th fret position. Our first finger's aligned on the 12th fret, but we're going to start with the bend with the 3rd finger on the 3rd string 14th fret. And this is a sort of a slow sustain bend, followed by what I refer to as a chicken pickin' bend. You know, buck buck, it's sort of a quick bend without any sustain. And then 14, 12, 14, 12. So, putting it together from the beginning with the slow bend. And then we pivot down 2 frets and we end with a bend on the 12th fret. Let's piece that whole riff together one more time. 1, 2, ready, go. Now, I'm using light gauge strings, which is the standard gauge that most guitarists use. Jimmy Page uses extra light gauge strings on the recording for Stairway to Heaven. The strings are thinner, they're easier to bend, but it produces a thinner sound on the bend as well. So, again, depending on what gauge string you have and what your preference is, you have another option for this riff, and that is to play it off the second string. It will be at a different fret position, though, off the 10th fret. It'll sound something like this. For section 9, there'll also be a couple of options on how to play this riff. That's because it starts with a pretty extreme bend on the 2nd string 6th fret. So it depends on what gauge strings you're using. I'm using light gauge. The original recording, Jimmy Page is using extra light. But so it's a little easier with extra light strings because we're bending from the 6th fret to match the pitch 4 frets higher on the 10th fret. We're bending from F to A. And it's going to sound something like this. And that's kind of an extreme bend. It's pretty challenging to do. It sounds really cool, but you pretty much need the extra light gauge strings to do that. So what we're going to do, since most of us have light gauge strings, we're going to do a bend, but it's not going to be as strong, and no one's really going to notice too much. We're going to start with the 8th fret and bend up to the 10th. And then we have a descending riff, a nod to the A natural minor scale, because the 2nd string 6th fret is an F note. So we're adding an F note to the blues scale, and we're going to group these next few passages with a 4 count. 6, 5, 7, 5. And then 7-5-7-5 to the 2 string. So let's start with the bend. And then 6-5-7-5. 7-5-7-5 to the 2 string. And then a 3 note riff to end everything. And we throw a little vibrato right there. So let's put the whole riff together now, starting with the bend. 1, 2, ready. Go. For the final response riff, which is the final riff in the guitar solo, we're going to move up to the 17th fret position again, and we're playing within this A blues box pattern, but we're just focused on the top 2 strings. We're going to start with the 2nd string, 17th fret, and our first finger is going to be partially barred or flattened across those top 2 strings. So we start with that 2nd string, and then we're going to pull off on the 1 string from 20 to 17. We're going to use our 3rd finger because the frets are a little bit closer together as we move up. So this riff, we're going to repeat that. It's actually going to be played 4 consecutive times, but of course it's played pretty fast. And how you get that speed effect is by using a downstroke for the 2 string and an upstroke for the 1 string. We're going to play it 4 times. And then the final notes we play are going to be that 2nd string, and then we're going to end with the bend. So with that, let's put it together from the top. You kind of hold that bend as we lead into the final verse section. The riffs played for the song's coda or ending feature unison bends. And a unison bend, we'll do an example here with the first finger on the 2nd string 3rd fret and the 3rd finger on the 3rd string 5th fret. We're going to have our 2nd middle finger also on the 3rd string. That's going to help support the 3rd finger for bending. Unison bend, you take the 3rd string and you bend it up to match the pitch of the note we're fretting on the 2nd string. So that's the objective. That's the 2nd string note, 2nd string 3rd fret. Well, we bend to match that pitch. And the unison bend is when you play the 2 strings together. Sort of like a howling effect. And the coda is nothing but unison bends. So what we're going to do is show you, I think the best way to memorize this is we're going to divide it into 3 sections, and we're going to base everything off where our first finger is fretting. So the first unison bend is the example we just did. So we have our first finger on that 3rd fret. So the first set of notes will be 3, 5, 8, 10, 13. All unison bends, but that's where our first finger is going to be anchored. 3, 5, 8, 10, 13. So let's apply unison bends. Then we have a series of notes here. It's just between the 2nd or unison bends. Then I'll go between the 12th and the 13th frets. Now, once you get it down, you can listen to the recording for the exact timing, but let's just group those together. And then the final set of unison bends will go in this order, 15, 13, 12, 15, 13. can almost sort of hum it. Dun, 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 dun. Now let's apply unison bends to that. The last unison bend is sustained. Here we go. So let's put it all together from the top. One, two, ready, go.